Hello and welcome to lecture 2B. Today we're going to be talking about layers. We're going to go over the basics of the layers panel, the layer visibility options, how to organize layers, and then what happens when you flatten them and duplicate them and merge them and some of those things like that. So if you're unfamiliar with layers, it's a good idea to start thinking about it now and playing around in Photoshop. It's one of the basics of Photoshop that make it what it is. The things that you can do in Photoshop are most frequently tied to working with layers. Layers, if you're unfamiliar, are like sheets of clear plastic or acetate. Those of you that are old enough to remember in school, the days when your teacher would use a slide presentation with the old slide projectors, that's kind of like what this is. So you've got these sheets of clear material with an image fixed on it. As you layer those, it layers the images. That's the old school way. So Photoshop layers are somewhat similar though. You have transparent areas supported and you have pixels on a flat layer. And as you stack those up, you can build up a complex image and you can hide certain areas and show certain areas and work with them. So here's a view of the layers panel. Got a lot of options in here. There's a panel options button that the letter A indicates that little panel options button. All the panels in Photoshop have that panel menu button. And it's going to give you context-based tools that have to do with that particular panel. In the layers panel, there's a lot of things in there that we're not going to talk about right now, but do go in and look at it. Next up, and this is not in order of importance, it's just in order of the alphabet, basically. You've got the filter option. So you can filter different types of layers, which we're going to talk about types of layers on the very next slide. But just be aware that if you have different types of layers, many people aren't aware that you can sort those layers based on the type of layer that it is. Pixel image, an adjustment layer, text, a shape, a vector, or other options like that. You can sort by blend modes and all sorts of things. You can toggle that sort or filter on and off. Letter C is the icon for a layer group. A layer group is simply a way of organizing your layers. You can put multiple layers, effects, and adjustments inside of a layer group, and that's going to let you apply adjustments to the group as a whole. You can apply a layer mask. Remember our last lecture, you can apply a layer mask to a group as a whole so that a whole bunch of layers get the exact same mask or adjustment. It also makes things cleaner. On some files, you'll end up getting complex layer panels with tens, 20s, 30s, hundreds of layers. It can get pretty busy. And being organized and using groups that are much better named than just group one, as you see in the picture, will give you and your teammates, people that you're working with on your files, a quick and easy way to find things and navigate and turn visibility on and off. We'll talk about visibility in a minute too. All right, so D is pointing to an example of a layer. You see there's a thumbnail there, and it's showing a bunch of squares, the gray and white squares that we associate with transparency. So this particular layer is mostly transparent except for one little bit of pixels down there in the bottom right-hand side. And the layer name is goat. And you can probably guess that that is a layer that contains an image of a goat. We're on E. Now E shows layer effects. So anytime in Photoshop you see these little up and down arrows or in the toolbar, little to the right bottom corner arrows, those arrows mean there's more there. So pointing up means you can hide it. So the effects, the stroke that's applied to that dog layer, you can hide that in the layers panel. It doesn't change the effect of the stroke or the effect. It just hides that in the layers panel, cleans things up a little bit. Good practice to be in is whenever you save your document, your Photoshop document, collapse all the groups, collapse all the effects, and then hit save. And when the next person opens it up, for example, me grading your files, it's going to be nice and clean and tidy, and I don't have to sort through 100 things to find your stuff. Puts me in a good mood when I'm grading, and you want your teacher to be in a good mood when he's grading, right? Okay. Layer thumbnail, we talked about that already. G's pointing to an example of that layer. That is the background layer of this image, and we'll talk about background layers in a minute too. But layers panel has a lot of info in there. The lock, we didn't talk about that. We didn't talk about opacity yet and fill. Those are on another slide. We'll get to that. So let's talk about types of layers quickly here. So there are a few different main types of layers. The background layer is a very specific type of layer. If you look at the picture on the right, it's at the very bottom. And this particular image, it's just white. And there's a lock icon, a little padlock over to the right-hand side of that layer. There's the name is in italics as well. It says background in italic. And it has certain behaviors that apply to a background layer. We're not going to get too much into that, but whenever you create a document, you have an option, typically when you're creating a new document, that is, to set a background layer or to go with a transparent background. When you open a JPEG or some other type of image file, it's going to open that as the background layer if it's a flat file format. If you open up a document that supports layers or transparency, it won't necessarily be a background layer in it, or it may have its own background layer that may be something else. So anyways, just be aware, whenever I create a new document, if I forget to choose transparency to begin with, I'll usually just delete that background layer that's white and put whatever in there that I want to use for my particular document. I don't get a lot of benefit from using a background layer. If I open up a JPEG or some other kind of image document, I'll usually click that little lock icon right to begin with, which converts that from a background layer into a regular image layer. So an image layer, that's the next example. In this particular screenshot of the layers panel, layer one that you see there is an image layer. That means it's made up of pixels. That's all it means. So you have a bunch of pixels making up a layer. That's an image layer. An adjustment layer, we're going to talk a lot about adjustment layers in this class, and they're very, very useful. But the layer that you see levels one is the name of that layer. That's an adjustment layer. We haven't talked about what adjustments are, but an adjustment layer looks like that. It's going to show a little icon in place of a layer thumbnail that shows what that is. That's a levels adjustment. And then to the right of that, there will be a linked layer mask, which again, like I said, we'll get to that. But there's going to be a layer mask along with that. A fill layer, you can see right below levels one, there's color fill one. And these are, I didn't use my own advice here and I didn't name these appropriately, but color fill one, that's pretty descriptive. It's going to give you a little thumbnail of a color fill. You can double click on that. It's going to open up the properties and you can change the color, but it comes with a layer mask too. It can be filled with more than just a color though. You can put a gradient or a pattern in that. A shape layer is going to be just that, is a shape. So these are typically vector-based objects within Photoshop. So on your screen, you're going to see a display of pixels generated from whatever that vector is. So that's a little bit tricky to understand sometimes in Photoshop, but don't worry, it's not that complex. You'll get the hang of it. But shape layers look like that. That's what you'll see. There's in the bottom right-hand corner of the layer thumbnail, a little square with anchor points on it, indicating that that is a shape, not just a bunch of pixels like an image layer. Lastly, we have type layers. So type layers are always going to have a little T for the icon there. And then the name of the layer will be whatever part of that text fits within the layers panel. So in this case, the type layer, if you were seeing the document, would actually say this is a type layer. That's the text that's written in this file. And hence, that's the name of the layer too. So that's how that works. All right, so now let's go on to some of the basics of working with those layers. First off, and it's not shown on the screen, but it should be self-apparent, hopefully, is that you can reorder these. It's pretty simple to just grab one of these layers and drag it up or drag it down in that stack. And just like that example that I showed back at the beginning of the sheets of transparent plastic with images on them, just like that, if you put one on top of the other, it's going to show on top of the other. So changing the order in that stack from top to bottom just works exactly like you're looking at a stack of transparencies. So that's how that works. Aside from changing the order of those layers, you can also modify the visibility. Now, toggling the visibility just turns it on or off. So see where the A is pointing right there? There's a little eyeball icon. The name of that is the toggles layer visibility icon. It's a mouthful. I think I usually just call it the eyeball. So click that eyeball and it's going to turn off shape one. It'll still be there. It'll still exist. All we have to do to get it back is turn that eyeball on again. So we're not deleting it or anything. We're just hiding it from the display. If I were to save this file, it's going to still keep that in my PSD. As long as I have layers, it's going to keep the layers. intact with the visibility turned off. If I flatten this out to a different file format, which I'll talk about this at the end of the lecture, flattening, but if I flatten this, any layer that's got the visibility turned off is gone. So when you flatten, only what you see on the screen is going to be there. So if visibility is turned off and it's not seen on the screen, it'll be gone. Okay. Opacity is kind of like visibility, except you can do it gradually. So from 0 to 100%, we can make things semi-transparent or semi-opaque. Opacity at 100% means you cannot see through it. If we go down to 0, that means you can see through it. So as we slide that up from 0 to 100, it becomes more opaque. That's what that is. So that gives you a lot of functionality as well. You can accomplish a lot with adjusting the opacity. Blending things together involves opacity a lot of times. So you'll get some examples where you get to play around with that. Fill is very similar to opacity, and you may end up wondering at some point why there's a difference. But the difference is that fill, as it says there on the slide, does not hide the effects or layer styles. So personally, I don't find a huge amount of use for this. I work mostly with photographs, not effects and buttons and web graphics and things like that. So in this case, if you want to adjust the opacity of the pixels of your image, but not the effects that you've applied to it, that's how you do it. Okay. Layer organization, we'll talk about this a little bit more here on the next couple of slides. But this section here that I have highlighted in the red rectangle is the lock functions for layers. And they're kind of explanatory, hopefully, but you see the grid, that's transparent pixels, the paintbrush is image pixels, the little move icon or cursor is for position and artboards and all and so on. So anyways, if you're wondering what lock means, is you can't change it when it's locked. So if I click that padlock, it's going to lock the entire layer. I can't use the brush tool on it. I can't make a selection on it. I can't fill. I can't paste something on it. There's just nothing I can do with it. It's locked. So that protects you from making a mistake on something, for example, or changing or modifying something that you don't want to be changed. Locking transparent pixels is kind of nice because let's say I've got something selected in an image. I've got transparency around it and I want to just modify the pixels that are there. I want to brush on that or do whatever tool I'm using. And I don't want to make a mistake and go out into the transparent area. Rather than making a complex selection and applying a mask again and all that, I can just lock the transparent pixels. And then whatever I do is only going to affect the pixels of that layer, not the transparent areas. Image pixels is just the opposite. It locks the image pixels, and so whatever you do is only going to affect the transparency. Position simply means you can't move it, and artboards should be pretty explanatory as well. We haven't talked about artboards, obviously, but we'll get to that, hopefully. All right, filter layers. We talked about this briefly. I mentioned that you could filter based on a variety of things. There's a drop-down menu that lets you filter even further, based on the name, effect, mode, attribute, color, whether it's a smart object or not, and so on. So this is a powerful tool that lets you search your layers, and you'll use it if your documents get complicated enough, because sometimes it gets tricky to find it, you know, what you're working on or what you're looking for. All right, last up, this is important. Pay attention here. Take notes, take a mental picture, take a screenshot, bookmark the video, whatever you need to do. But remember this, okay? Merging and flattening. These are destructive changes that you'll apply to your image. Sometimes, hopefully never going to do this when you're not completely intentional about it. Accidentally flattening your document is going to lead to tears and weeping and wailing and all that good stuff. So please be careful that you don't merge or flatten unless you're really intending to do so. Some of the dialogues or commands, like converting colors and things like that, that we'll talk about later, they give you by default an option to flatten or merge your layers. So sometimes it can happen without you being aware of it. So you got to be vigilant and paying attention to what you're doing. All right. So more about the definition of what these are. If I have an image with a whole bunch of layers, like the screenshots that we've been looking at, merge is going to rasterize the selected layers and combine them into a single layer. So in simple terms, what that means is we're going to take 10 layers or 20 layers or 2 layers or whatever we've got selected, and it's going to combine them into a single layer. That means I lose the ability to work with those layers individually that I had. And I'm throwing away a whole bunch of image information when I do that. Flatten is even more destructive because that takes everything that's visible in your image, selected or not, and it merges that into a new background layer. You don't have transparency anymore. So if my layers had transparency, that's gone, and I just have a background fill, whatever it was. So be aware when you're doing that. Typically, the only time you want to flatten your image is once you've safely saved a copy of it that still has your layers intact. Then you're going to flatten a copy for delivery to your client or in your output, whatever that's going to be. So you're not going to send your client a layered PSD because it may not be very useful to them, or you may not want them messing it up. So before you send that off, you'll flatten it. It's going to reduce your file size a lot to flatten your image, but it also throws away the editability of that document. Merge visible in between those two. It's going to do a merge, not a flatten, but it doesn't matter whether you've got layers selected or not. It's going to just merge things that are visible. So if you have layers that the visibility is turned off, they'll be safe. They won't be merged. But if they're visible, they will be merged. So, all right, a lot of information there. Again, go through in Photoshop, play around with layers, make some new layers, put a bunch of photos in a document, copy and paste. Works well for just getting a lot of different content into a document quickly. Go on Google Images and just start grabbing images and then copy, paste, Control-C, Control-V, or Command-C, Command-V on a Mac. We'll let you pull images right out of your browser and put them in Photoshop documents. So play around with that. Here's the things that we've covered, and we'll go on from here.